Arabic peoples plus, it's not just the Arabic peoples, there are others that trace their descendant to Ishmael, and then from that line came Muhammad. Somebody asked me a question afterwards, and I realized somebody may have been confused. Between Abraham and Jesus, there are 2,000 years. All of it's right in here, in between the tribes of Israel and Jesus. This should be a broken line, I think, because there's a lot of generations in there. Same thing over here. Between the 12 tribes of Ishmael and Muhammad, there's 2,500 years. So don't make the mistake of thinking Muhammad was a direct next generation after the 12 tribes of Ishmael. All right? I'm sure most of you got that, but somebody asked me a question that I might not have been clear about that. Okay? We start in the story of Islam after Abraham with the prophet Muhammad. The name Muhammad means highly praised. Muhammad was born in the city of Mecca in Saudi Arabia. Well, we know as Saudi Arabia. It was just Arabia back then. It wasn't until the family Saud in the 20th century that it was renamed Saudi Arabia. He was born in 570. He was orphaned as a young child and was raised by his uncle. As a young man, he worked in camel caravans. He was a camel driver. And so he traveled pretty extensively up into Syria, around the Arabian Peninsula. He had a lot of exposure to different groups of people, different ethnic groups, as well as people who were Jewish, Christian, and pagan. All of those were there at that time. Because remember, this is in the late 500s, so Christianity had been around for more than five centuries, and Judaism much longer than that. At age 25, Muhammad married a woman. She had actually been his employer. Khadija was her name. She was 15 years older than him. And for the next 24 years until Khadija died, Muhammad did not marry again. Now, that it was common, in fact, almost absolutely the rule, that men married multiple wives back then. And yet his dedication to Khadija, who was her first, she was his first convert, to the Islamic belief, she supported him and encouraged him for 24 years. He did not remarry until after her death. So, when he was 40 years old, in 1610, Muhammad, who was a very spiritual man, he would go up into the mountains, into the caves, and pray and seek spiritual guidance. Well, when he was 40 years old, one of these visits to the cave, he came back from it to his wife Khadija and said, "Either I'm going insane or God has spoken to me." And he talked to her about it. He continued to go up to visit the caves and continued to hear God speak to him, actually speak to him through the angel Gabriel, or Jibril, as they call it in Arabic. Khadija encouraged him that it sounded like this really was God speaking. And so she became his first convert. He began to share with other people because the instructions he said he received from the angel Gabriel was that he was to proclaim or recite, depending on how you translate it. The word for that is Quran, and that's why the holy book is called the Quran, because it is what the angel Gabriel told him to recite so that it be written down. Now, Muhammad was illiterate. He did not write the Quran, but he received it, he recited it to his early followers, and they wrote it down, those who were literate. At first, he had very few converts. In fact, in the first 3 years of his ministry, of his proclaiming this message, he only had 40 converts. But those 40 converts were trying to share this new message, and particularly the message was, stop the polytheistic pagan idol worship, there is only one God. And then also there was, Muhammad's instructions were that while God had spoken to the Jews and had spoken to the Christians, both Moses and Jesus are considered prophets, not ultimate prophets, which Muhammad is, but had been prophets, that God had spoken to them, but then the scriptures that he had given them, in terms of the Torah, or Torah, as it's called in Arabic, and the Gospels, were corrupted by people's desiring it to say what they wanted it to say, according to Muhammad. And so he was to both correct the mistakes that had crept into what had been godly religions, Judaism and Christianity, and especially to get rid of the pagan worship. This was not very popular in Mecca, in his hometown, because Mecca had this temple called the Kaaba, which we've seen already, we'll look at again, which had a lot of pagan idols in it, and it was a place of pagan pilgrimage. A lot of people came there because of this Kaaba, this big stone, and the idols there, and there was a lot of money coming from this. So when Muhammad's trying to tell him to get rid of this stuff, and to not be materialistic, and that they needed to not be so greedy and selfish, none of that played very well with the people in Mecca. And so there was a great deal of persecution. They were mocked. They were beaten with sticks. They were stones thrown at them. They had dirt sprayed on them when they were kneeling to pray. And so it got very difficult. In 622, there was a visit from people in a northern town, which at that time was called Yathrib. This is the Saudi Arabian Peninsula. We're right there, right now. We're right there. Mecca was where Muhammad lived, where he was born, grew up. The city north of there originally was called Yathrib. And while they were being persecuted by the people of Mecca, a group of men came down from Yathrib and said, "We hear that you are a really good leader, and we need somebody that can draw together different factions up in Yathrib, and would you come and be our leader?" He agreed to do that. When the authorities in Mecca found out about it, they were very unhappy, and so they barely escaped. The trip from Mecca to Medina under persecution, they were running for it, led by both Muhammad and his closest friend Abu Bakr, who ended up being his father-in-law later. They escaped Mecca, and this pilgrimage, if you will, is called the Hajira. And it's in our date, 622. That is considered the start of Islam, the official start of Islam. So that's why when those of you who were in the museum, the Frankincense Museum in Salalah, there were two dates on everything. They had a date that said AD, which is our calendar, because they know a lot of people come from the West there. But they also have a date that had an H. This is the year of Hajira 1436, right now. It's 2015 by the Western calendar, 2015 AD, but it's 1436 according to the Muslim calendar, which started in 622. It's also different because they use a lunar calendar, which is 11 days shorter than the solar calendar that we use. But that trip from Mecca up to what got renamed Medina. Medina means the city. It actually was named Madinat al-Nabi in Arabic, which means the city of the Prophet. Later on, it got shortened just to Medina. These are the two holy cities of Islam. Mecca, where the Prophet came from, and Medina, where he was first received. After that, there was a huge battle over a period of time between Muhammad and his forces in Medina and Mecca. From time to time, the people of Mecca would come up and attack. It's 280 miles between these two cities. But they would attack, trying to get rid of what they thought was this bad influence. And then there would be battles from the people from Medina under Muhammad coming back down to fight. And it sort of went back and forth for quite a while. Finally, in 630, the forces under Muhammad from Medina conclusively defeated the forces in Mecca. Muhammad and his companions went in and they cleared out all the pagan idols. The city of Mecca was converted to Islam, and that continued for the next 2 years. Muhammad died in 632. All right, so that's the history. By the way, I should say, I'm going to give you quite a bit of history to start out because you have to know something about the history to understand Islam. There are particular periods in history that if you don't know about them, you're not going to understand any of the things that go on in Islam, either historically or today. All right? So this is the schedule, the history. 570, Muhammad is born. 610, he receives the first revelation of the Quran, the recitation, in a cave on the mountain above Mecca. 622 is the Hajira, the pilgrimage from Mecca to Medina. In 630, they return to Mecca, defeat the opposition, and Mecca is converted to Islam. And then in 632, Muhammad dies. By that time, most of the Arabian Peninsula had been converted. I've said to you several times that Oman is especially proud that they were very receptive to this message and some of the early converts. After Muhammad, there are a series of successors. The Arabic word for successor is caliph. A series of caliphs who follow after him and launch a series of military campaigns to conquer much of the Mediterranean region, at least on the eastern end of the Mediterranean. This map, which you've seen, all of the dark orange is where during Muhammad's life, including over here in Oman, that was converted to Islam. The next four, and I'm going to talk about, the next four of the caliphs or successors, called the Rashidun or rightly guided successors, conquered most of about halfway over of North Africa, most of the Levant, Middle East, all the way over toward Afghanistan and all of the Arabian Peninsula. And then we have other groups coming along after that. This period The Rashidun, or rightly guided caliphs, is critical to understanding Islam. The next four successors or caliphs after Muhammad were Abu Bakr, one of his closest friends and one of the real leaders amongst his companions, Umar, Uthman, and Ali. Now, a critical thing happened when Muhammad died. There was a huge controversy over succession. Who should take over? There was one group called the Shi'atu Ali who believed that this should be a hereditary succession. Muhammad did not have any sons. He had several daughters. He did not have any sons that survived. And so there was a group that thought the person who should now become our leader, the caliph, the successor to Muhammad, should be his closest male relative, which happened to be Ali. You'll see his name up there. Ali was a cousin, a blood cousin, and also his son-in-law, married to his daughter Fatima. However, Ali was not considered by most of them to be the best guy to lead. And so it is at this point that the division between those who supported Ali, the Shi'atu Ali, the party of Ali, Shi'atu became Shia, and those who believe that we should follow the way that Muhammad, in other words, whoever is the best leader in the model of Muhammad, whoever can lead us most like Muhammad will, whether he's related to him or not, should be the one. Well, that other group, the group called the Sunni, or the way, or tradition, more of the people supported that idea that let's get the best guy, not the one that's blood relation. And so that was the point at which Sunni and Shia started having a problem with each other. That very first thing. Well, Abu Bakr, the closest companion to Muhammad, is elected as the first caliph, the first successor to Muhammad, and he begins to lead them. The first thing that happens, and by the way, I expect you to memorize this chart. This is the genealogy of Muhammad, and this is very important because to Muslims, because it's very important what tribe you belong to. That was one of the other disagreements, is there were some people, both Shia and Sunni, who still felt that even if he's not a close blood relation, he should come from the Quraysh tribe, which was the tribe of Muhammad. They still argue over that. Is it legitimate to have a caliph, a religious leader especially, who is from a different tribe? Well, this is Muhammad. The first of the caliphs is Abu Bakr, who's right down here. He was his father-in-law. Abu Bakr came in, the very first thing that he had to do as the first successor to Muhammad is much of Islam, many of the people who converted to Islam, decided they didn't like the idea. Remember, we'll talk about the alms that they have to pay, 2.5% of their wealth every year. And so they immediately had a lot of people who say, wow, Muhammad's dead, we're not going to do this anymore. So the first thing that Abu Bakr had to do when he became caliph was the campaign on the apostasy, where he went with his army all the way through the Arabian Peninsula and forced people back into the faith and forced people to continue to pay the alms that were necessary, the 2.5%. He then, and he only was, it was less than 3 years that he was in power as caliph before his death, he started the conquests. Using the army that they had developed, the Muslim army, he started taking over territory beyond what had already existed and conquering them politically for Islam. Now, a common misunderstanding is, at this point at least, the early caliphs did not force people to convert to Islam. Abu Bakr made them, those who had already claimed to be Muslim, made them come back into the faith and pay their taxes. But when they conquered an area, they defeated the government and they took over political control. They did not force people to become Muslim. The people who were not Muslim, remember the Muslims were paying 2.5% every year as an alms. They required non-Muslims who were in the areas they controlled to pay a tax instead. And that tax was intended to provide for the support in the government and all of that sort of thing. Okay, so that's often a misunderstanding. As I say, Abu Bakr only lived for less than 3 years, and all the time there are still people who are arguing it should be Ali. It should be the closest blood relation. It should be hereditary, not elected. Well, the second caliph, before Abu Bakr died, he looked around and he said the next best person to lead us is named Umar. Umar just happened to be another one of the father-in-laws of Muhammad, the father of one of his next wives. Now, all these wives came after Khadijah had died. Well, he served for almost 10 years, or right about 10 years, and he's very important because Umar developed the political structure. He's the one that decided with all of this land that we're conquering, because he continued the conquests, with all this land that we're conquering, how are we going to run all this? He created the political structure. He also established the Islamic calendar. It was him that said, we start our calendar, it's a lunar calendar, as was the Arabic calendar before that, but it starts on the year of the Hijra. And so he created that, and that's very important because that directs a lot of the religious activities within Islam. He continued the conquests, and one of the things that had happened is up north of the Levant, in the area around Syria, in Iraq, etc., you had the Sassanid Persians that were in the east, and you had the Byzantine Christian Empire that was based in Constantinople, and they had pretty much worn each other out. They had been fighting wars for a long time. They militarily were just exhausted, and so it was very easy under Umar for them to move north through the Levant up into this area and conquer both the Sassanid areas and much of what had been the Byzantine Empire in Anatolia. All right? So Umar is the second of the caliphs, and he lasted almost 10 years, but when they conquered the Sassanid Empire, that was Persia. And so he had a Persian slave who ended up assassinating him, and after he'd been in power about 10 years. The third caliph, and this one was controversial because the first two, Abu Bakr and Omar, had been part of the Quraysh tribe. Well, when they looked around at this point, you had people the whole time saying, Ali, it should be Ali, it should be the hereditary heir, the blood relation. Well, Uthman was not from the same tribe. He was not from the Quraysh tribe, although he was Islamic. He was a close follower and companion of Muhammad, but he was from the Umayyad tribe. Still, they elected him over the objections of the people who were advocating still for Ali. He came into power, and he was not father-in-law, but a son-in-law of Muhammad's, because Muhammad did have daughters that survived, so you've got all of these marriage relationships going on here. His greatest, or perhaps most important activity, was he was the one that formalized the Quran, the holy writings, the one that said, okay, this is the form it's going to take, set it down, it's finished. Now, they don't believe he changed it. They believe that the Muslims of the world believe that the Quran is exactly how it was given to Muhammad, and it has never been changed or corrupted. If you go into a mosque, if you hear someone talking about Islam, they will almost always say that the Quran is completely the way it was given, it has never been changed, unlike the Hebrew scriptures and unlike the Christian scriptures. Did some of you all, those of you who went to the mosque in Salalah, did you have a guide that talked to you about all that? Okay, previously when we went there, they made a big point of that the Quran has never been changed. Well, he formalized the Quran, he continued the Muslim conquest. One of the things he did was he conquered much of North Africa, and in taking over in Egypt, a lot of the Egyptians became advocates for Ali being in charge, and so they were upset about the fact that this guy not only wasn't a blood relation, he wasn't even of the same tribe. He ruled for about 12 years. The first 6 years was the most he was the most popular of all of the caliphs for the first 6 years. For the last 6 years, there was constant upheaval and rebellion. And in fact, when they had rebellion in Egypt against his rule, he refused to suppress it by force of arms because he believed that would be Muslims fighting against Muslims, and he didn't believe in doing that. Well, as a result of that, and because he did not take firmer action, he was assassinated by those Egyptian rebels. The story is that he was in his house reading the Quran one night, and they broke in and killed him. So, you notice that two of the first three of the caliphs were assassinated. Then, finally, Ali becomes the fourth caliph. He served from 656 to 661. He was, as I said before, both the cousin, he was a blood relation, and the son-in-law. He was married to Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad. He continued the Muslim conquests, but early on, one of the things he did, and this was believed to be political, he replaced some of the governors and officials that were part of the Islamic controlled areas now, who were related to Uthman. He got rid of them and put his own people in place. And people thought that was politically motivated because Uthman was not part of their tribe. Then there was a huge problem that came up because Aisha, one of the wives of Muhammad, was very upset that Ali did not take revenge against the people that were accused of killing, assassinating Uthman, the previous caliph. Aisha got together with some of Uthman's Umayyad brothers, fellows, and they put together an army. They marched north, because the other thing that Ali had done is he moved the capital from Medina up north to Kufa in Iraq. So they march up there, and they, when they get to one of the cities near Kufa, they accuse 4,000 people of participating in the assassination of Uthman, and they kill them. So Ali marches out with his army, and Aisha and the Umayyads have their army. They don't actually want to fight, but in night, with these two armies facing each other, a war breaks out, even though the leaders didn't really want that. This became known as the first Muslim civil war. There actually were three of them. The first time Muslims were fighting against Muslims. And the at that point, there was a very powerful leader of the Umayyad clan, the Umayyad tribe, named Muawiyah. Muawiyah was the one working with Aisha to come here and fight this battle. And they... the story was that Muawiyah and Ali's forces come up against each other, and Muawiyah has his Umayyad tribe forces take pages of the Quran and stick it on the end of their spears. And so Ali's forces don't want to fight them because they're holding the word of God. They agree to have arbitration. An arbitrator comes in and decides, you know, what's going to happen to try to calm everything down and settle it down. The problem is some of the people that were Islamic at that point felt that if Ali was truly the proper caliph, successor, he should never have submitted to arbitration. That was dishonoring to his position as the leader of the Muslim world. And so there was a group of them called the Kharijites. These Kharijites rise up and they have a plot to assassinate Ali and Muawiyah, the guy that was on the other side, and the arbitrator. They're successful in killing Ali, they're not successful in killing Muawiyah, and he takes over. Because he was from the tribe of the Umayyads, this is the end of the Rashidun, the four Rashidun caliphs, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, and Ali, and the start of a new regime, which is called the Umayyad Caliphate. Caliphate means the rule of a caliph. This is the area that was taken by force of arms by the first four of the caliphs. Again, part of the Arabian Peninsula, this area down here, had already been under the control of Islam because of Muhammad. But they went all the way up to Afghanistan and all of Iran, all of Iraq, all of Syria, all of the Levant, up into Anatolia, Armenia, Azerbaijan, Egypt, Libya, etc. All of that was under the control. At this time, it was one of the largest and the fifth largest empire ever, and one of the largest empires that had yet been on the earth. So this was pretty significant stuff. We then end up, as I said, this was the end of the first caliphate, the Rashidun Caliphate, and it is the start of the Umayyad Caliphate, which was the tribe that Uthman had been part of, and it's under Muawiyah. This caliphate proceeds with the policy of conquering. The interesting thing about Muawiyah, though, is he was especially moderate in how he treated other people. His wife was a Christian. And Muawiyah made a special point in the areas that they conquered of having Christians, especially highly qualified Christians, that at that point, a lot of the Christian, they were Christians from the Byzantine Empire, they tended to be better educated, they were very skilled, and there were a lot of Christians in authority then. He expanded, that is, or they expanded, the Umayyad Caliphate, all the way over through all of North Africa. This area in western North Africa is called the Maghreb, if you ever see that word. They took, solidified the areas in the east, and they crossed over the Gibraltar and took over most of the Iberian Peninsula, what we know of as Spain and Portugal. I showed you the map before where they then were sending armies all the way up into France, and Charles Martel, the grandfather of Charlemagne, Charles the Great, ended up beating them back, and Charles Martel and his son Pepin the Short, I love that name, they were Catholics, and Pepin the Short and then Charles the Great, Charlemagne, ended up pushing them back further. During this period of time, however, under the Umayyad Caliphate, they have a second Muslim civil war, They have a revolt by the Berbers of North Africa that have converted to Islam, but they're fighting. A lot of this had to do with who is in charge. There were still people who felt like Islam should not be controlled by somebody who's not part of the Quraysh, Muhammad's tribe, or one of his relatives. And so they're fighting battles. They ended up finally, the Third Civil War, which occurred in the mid-700s, ended the Umayyad Caliphate. But one of the things, how many of you all have been to Spain and visited the Moorish sites there? All right? That's because even after the Umayyads are beaten back and a new dynasty comes in, or a new caliphate comes in, they continued here in Cordoba. And if you go there today and you see the Alhambra and these extraordinary Muslim, Moorish as they call them, sites, that's because the last descendants of the Umayyads stayed there, and they stayed there for another 350, almost 400 years. So this is where the Umayyads were traveling up into Western Europe. Here they were going up toward Byzantium or Constantinople. Later on, they would be driven out of Western Europe, but they would conquer and go all the way up to Venice. So the Umayyad Caliphate ended around 750, and a new group, the Abbasid Caliphate, comes in. The Abbasid Caliphate were led by, they came back to the idea of a blood relation. The youngest uncle of Muhammad takes over. And that becomes the Abbasid Caliphate. This is the time of the golden age of Islam. He had lived in modern day Iraq. And so the capital, they built the city of Baghdad at this time. And this was the descendants of the youngest uncle of Muhammad. They build the city of Baghdad. They create the golden age of Islam, where they had learning. The goal was to take all of the great writing of history, the Greek philosophers, the Greek playwrights, every culture that they had influence on or that they controlled, they were taking all of the great writings and bringing it together. It was a time of great medicine and astronomy and mathematics. Western Europe, obviously we weren't around yet, but Western Europe did not come anywhere close to this for another 1,000 years almost in terms of what they were doing in the 700s in the Umayyad or the Abbasid Caliphate, centered primarily in Baghdad. The problem was, for all of their learning and the golden age and all of the scholarship and the collecting of all this wisdom, they didn't do a very good job of ruling. And so slowly, one part of the Abbasid Caliphate after another gets taken away from them. The Umayyads, the last of the Umayyads, take over part of the Maghreb, the Western North Africa, and Cordoba, Andalusia it was called, still called today, but that was Al-Andalus was the Arabic name, and various other groups. And in fact, they finally lose North Africa to the Fatimid dynasty, which is the next one to come along. Now, you remember I told you that Ali, who was the one that some people thought should have been the caliph all along, he was married to Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad. The only time in Islamic history that Shia had any power was the very brief time, just a few years, under Ali himself and under the Fatimid dynasty. The descendants of the daughter Fatima and Ali created a Shia dynasty in North Africa. This is Fatima, closest to Muhammad. This was Ali, the last of the Rashidun caliphates. They slowly, slowly began to take more and more property away from the Abbasids. The Abbasids were still around, but they weren't controlling the land anymore. And this was the Fatimid dynasty from the 900s to almost 1200. This was the only time that the Shia movement had any power, political power. The whole rest of the history, it has been controlled by the Sunni, the tradition that started with the Rashidun caliphates. They made Cairo their capital. That's how Cairo came to be a great city. They had created a capital in Cairo, and from there they led the whole caliphate of the Fatimids. Now there was, for the most part during that time, they were still very tolerant of other beliefs, especially Jews and Christians, because Jews and Christians are considered in Islam people of the book, meaning they were given holy writings. However, they believed they were corrupted. But in the 11th century, we begin to have some of these Fatimid caliphs, particularly one in the 11th century called the Mad Caliph, Al-Hakim. He starts going over here to the Holy Land and destroying the Christian shrines that had been built there. The first shrine over the Tomb of the Holy Sepulchre, he destroyed it. And he was persecuting pilgrims who were coming there. There had always been an understanding that Jews and pilgrims had free travel under the other Islamic leaders. Well, Al-Hakim, the Mad Caliph, started persecuting them. This was one of the things that directly led to the Crusades. And we're going to do a talk on the Crusades after the Suez Canal. We'll get into that. Well, in 1171, a Kurdish general who had been the vizier, the grand vizier, a major figure in the Fatimid Caliphate, he gets tired of these crazy caliphs, these crazy guys in charge. And he conquers the Fatimid Caliphate and declares himself the Sultan. This is the Ayyubid dynasty. You'll notice it's dynasty because and this is Saladin. If you've studied anything about the Crusades or the wars, Saladin and Richard the Lionheart from England, they had this, I mean, they fought battles against each other, but they had this great respect for each other. He became a hero, to some people even in the West, because he was known to be very honorable. He conquered the Fatimids because he wanted to stop all this craziness. He did not declare himself caliph. That's why it's not called the Ayyubid Caliphate. It's called the Ayyubid Dynasty, because he was the sultan, but he was not the religious leader. During this time, up in the, and this is what the Ayyubid Dynasty looked like, you'll notice that the control under the Fatimids and under the Ayyubids, up in here, this is Turkey, the Persian area, they did not control a lot of that anymore. The people, the Islamic rulers there, when the Abbasids were still in control, they had invited a bunch of warriors to come in from Turkey. Remember, the Abbasids kept losing their territory. They were losing territory to the Byzantines were fighting back. They were losing it to various other groups. They recruited these vicious warriors from Turkmenistan. And they were called the Turks. And they came over to help fight for the Abbasids. And then later on, they said, wait a minute, we've got all the power. Why are we listening to you guys? And so they took over. They had converted to Islam. They became the Seljuk Turks. And they controlled the area throughout Persia. They were very Persian. That's why Turkey has a lot of sort of Persian influence, you know, the Fezes and all that kind of stuff, because the Seljuk Turks conquered that whole northern area and ended up taking over Anatolia. This is what the Seljuk Turks looked like. And they fought major battles. They defeated the Byzantine army. They controlled all of this. All of this area had been part of the Byzantine kingdom at one time, or empire, and all the way up to the gates of Istanbul, which are right there. This is the point at which, both because, and this is the same period of time, it's the late 11th, early 12th century, this is when the cry went out from the leaders in Constantinople, the Byzantine leaders, to Western Europe, especially to the Pope, saying, help! We've got these Islamic Turks right outside our gates trying to conquer our city. Well, in the 1400s, they succeeded. And that's why today Turkey is 98% Islamic. So the Seljuk Turks take over, and one event, they start out, they've got a bunch of princes controlling different areas. One of those princes, whose name was Osman the First, ends up getting control of the whole deal. And we don't know how. To this day, the historians don't know how it was that one of these guys, Osman, ended up being the one who was ruling everything. But from Osman, we got the Ottoman Empire, which you cannot see down here, but it says the Ottoman Empire. Osman got changed to Ottoman, and it's at its height in the 16th century under Suleiman the Magnificent. They controlled all of Anatolia, all of the areas of most of what we consider Iran, Iraq, the Levant, all of Egypt, most of North Africa, all the way over to the gates of Vienna. For almost 100 years, the Muslim armies were threatening Vienna, and they controlled all of Eastern Europe. So they declined. The Ottoman Empire was in place for, in this case, 1500, but for almost 1,000 years. I mean, the Ottomans, from starting with the Seljuk Turks till till the 1900s, the Ottoman Empire existed. This is what the Ottoman Empire eventually came to look like. The darker area, or the lighter area, is where they controlled all of Eastern Europe, all of North Africa, Egypt, the Hejaz, this area that has Mecca and Medina. The reason why they don't indicate down here is there wasn't a whole lot in the center of Arabia. A big chunk of this they still call the empty quarter, because there's nothing there. But unfortunately, the Ottoman Empire, while they started out grand, they got very weak. In fact, they became known as the sick old man of Europe. Everybody started fighting back. At first, there was a group of Western European powers. They called themselves the Holy League. They fought back against Turkey, the Ottoman Empire. Sometimes they just call it Turkey because it was the Turks. They pushed them back out of Europe. First, the countries in here, Bulgaria, Serbia, Greece, and eventually, by the time of the First World War, the Ottoman Empire had lost all of these territories, and they were limited just to Anatolia, which we know as Turkey, the area in very tip of Europe by Istanbul, and then the areas down here. Egypt, in fact, while they technically still controlled it, the British had moved into Egypt, and they said they did so because they were looking out for the interests of the people, and they were, in effect, in control there. This was the last great Muslim empire, the Ottomans. And of course, in the First World War, the Ottoman Empire made the mistake. The Ottoman Empire had started looking to Germany, especially, which was the new military power at the start of the 20th century, to protect them from all of these other people who were trying to drive them off of, out of Europe, including the Russians. Because the Russians were up here, and they had a desire to control some of these areas that the Ottoman Empire had controlled. So they aligned themselves with Germany. When the First World War starts in 1914, the Ottoman Empire declares that they are with Germany and Austro-Hungary as the central powers, they were called. And it was a bad choice because they lost that war. They lost the First World War. And at the end of the First World War, the Ottoman Empire was broken up into a lot of different countries that we know today. The last of the sort of the Turkish influence countries took the name Turkey. And it was because of a man named Ataturk. I mean, Ataturk means father of the Turks. It's Jamal. Why am I forgetting his full name? I'll think of it in a minute. So that's the history, the whole history. All the way along there, the problem has always been that when Muhammad died, there were a group of people, and they have never forgotten this, that advocated that it should have been Ali or at least a member of the Quraysh tribe. They have only, when Ali was the caliph for a few years and under the descendants of Ali and his wife Fatima and the Fatimid regime caliphate in North Africa, otherwise they have never been in power. And they have always felt persecuted and oppressed because of that. Now, I want to talk a little bit about some of those differences now. If you thought Islam was one thing and was simple, when you got on this boat, if there's nothing else you remember about this talk, when you get off the boat, I hope you can tell people it's way more complicated than Christianity or virtually any other major religion. From under the heading of Islam, you've got Sunni is the largest. It's 85 to 90%, depending on how you carve it up. Then you have Shia. Shia is about 10% of the total Islamic world. And then the descendants of the Khwarizmi, they're the people that that created such a problem and assassinated Ali. Their descendants are the Ibadis. And the Ibadis are where?
Oman.
Oman is there are some Ibadis elsewhere in the Middle East, but it's predominantly, that is the tradition, the Islamic tradition in Oman, and that's separate from Shia and Sunni. Within Sunni, there are a number of different schools, meaning a number of different theological beliefs that fall under Sunni. Particularly, if you can read these, Hanafi, Hanbali, Maliki, and Shafi'i. Each of those has a predominant geographical area that they cover. The Hanafi is in Turkey, Jordan, Syria, Afghanistan, Pakistan, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, the Turkmen that are spread out, and some in India. So it's a large one. After that, you have the Hanbali, school or discipline of Sunni, and that is in Saudi Arabia and Qatar. The third is the Maliki, which is in the United Arab Emirates and Kuwait, predominantly. There's no hard and fast lines. It's not like you get to the border and it changes. You then have the Shafi'i, which is in Yemen, Sri Lanka, and Indonesia. So there's a large number of those because Indonesia is the biggest Islamic country. That's just in the Sunni side. And then there's some other smaller offshoots of all of that. You get the Sufi mystics down here. Then under Shia, the other 10%, you've got Ismailism and a bunch of other stuff. I'm going to show you a separate chart for that. This is, and we'll get to Shia because that's even more complicated. This is how it's broken out. The Hanafi is this lighter green area here. The Hanbali is the darker green in Saudi Arabia especially. The Maliki is the lighter blue, that, you know, it's mostly in here in the Gulf states. And then the Shafi'i, Indonesia, East Africa, and some other areas in Egypt, etc. That's just Sunni. The Shia has several different schools as well, but the best way to explain that is this chart. I told you it's complicated. One of the big differences between Sunni, which is by far the largest, and Shia is the Sunni believe that God gives imams as teachers, but that they are subject to the common knowledge of the Ummah, or the Islamic people. Whereas the Shia, remember, they're very person-oriented. They believe that it should be hereditary. The Shia faith of Islam believes that God sends divinely anointed, infallible religious leaders. They felt that they did not have anybody like that from the 900s up until the 1970s. You remember what happened in early 1970 that made all the news? In Iran? The Ayatollah Khomeini, who was in exile in France, the Shah of Iran fell. The Ayatollah Khomeini came back to Iran, and the very idea of Ayatollah is that he was believed to be an infallible religious leader. They believed that whatever he said was directly from God, and that's one of the aspects of Shia. That's why that was such a big deal, is for the first time in more than 1,000 years, they finally had somebody that they believed was God's divinely appointed prophet for them, who was without fail. Nothing he said could be wrong. Shia believed that men have been given divine, infallible authority by God. Now, still within Shia, without understanding, there are a number of different groups, and it depends upon how, which people they track their beliefs back through. In particular, these groups often have number names. Let me flip over here and I'll... Along the bottom, these are the various parties or movements or groups within, and it's hard for you to read that, but you might notice there is one group that's called the Zaidi. They're also referred to as Fivers. There's Fivers, Seveners, Twelvers. The reason they're called Fivers is because they believe that Ali was the first legitimate caliph, then his two sons, Hassan and Hussein, and then the Zain al-Abidan, and then Zaid. So there were five legitimate caliphs. They don't accept anybody after that as being legitimate. They believe that God's perfect line of leaders in the faith ended after five. So they're called Fivers or Zaidis. There's another group that believe that after Zain al-Abidin, Muhammad al-Taqir, and on down through Jafar Sadiq and Ismail, they are called the Ismailis or Seveners because they believe there are seven legitimate caliphs after Muhammad. You then have the group that believes that after Jafar, we get over here to, I'm not going to read all the names, a whole series down to Muhammad al-Mahdi, that there were 12 legitimate caliphs, and they are called?
Twelvers.
Twelvers. Commonly, and you know, they refer to themselves that way. This is not something that we've impressed on them. This is the one that people have more concern about because this last, they believe the last legitimate caliph, or the Mahdi, Muhammad al-Mahdi, that he, in the 900s, that he went into what's called an occultation, meaning he disappeared from view. But they believe he's still around. We just don't see him. They believe at some point in the future, Jesus, that is Christian Jesus, who they believe is a prophet, will return, and as a he'll be sort of the John the Baptist to the Mahdi, and at that point the Mahdi, the 12th Imam, will reappear, and that will mark the end time. And there will be a whole lot of stuff that goes on related to that. But there's a lot of mysticism related to this. You then get various other caliphs that came along, or imams, leaders. The Druze movement, you get the Nizaris. Are you familiar with the name Aga Khan?
Yeah.
Okay, you know the Aga Khan. The Aga Khan is the head of the Naziri branch of Shia, right here. The Aga Khan, if you don't know, he's a wealthy Englishman. He lives in England anyway. He's famous for being a fan of race cars and got some of the richest horses in the world. He races horses. He's a businessman. He is considered by the Naziri sect of Shia to be infallible. And so they look to the modern Aga Khan. I mean, he wears, you know, $2,000 suits and quite the character. And then you get all of these other sort of smaller groups that that follow that, including some that is like the Druze that most of Islam does not consider to be legitimate Islam. Is this complicated?
Yeah.
It is not one thing. And some of these groups believe, that are more militant, believe that the other groups within Shia or between Shia and Sunni are heretics, that they have defiled God's word and his will, and therefore they are more against each other than they are anybody in the West. And this is why you end up with things like what's happening right over there in Yemen. Because Yemen is by population, a predominantly Shia country. However, in almost every case, and this was true when Saddam Hussein was in charge of Iraq, they had more Shia than they did Sunni, but the Sunnis were in charge. Saddam Hussein was Sunni. The president that got ousted in Yemen was Sunni. Well, the majority, who tend to be poorer, less well-educated, less well-organized, from time to time, like in Yemen, they have risen up and thrown the Sunni leaders out. That's what happened here. The Sunni president of the country fled into Saudi Arabia. He's being supported by Saudi Arabia because Iran, the only predominantly the only Shia country in the world where they actually are running things, they are supporting the Houthi Shiite rebels in Yemen. Saudi Arabia, which is vastly majority is Sunni, they are very concerned that Shia Iran does not gain more control in the region, especially on the Arabian Peninsula. And so that's why Saudi Arabia is bombing to try to stop the Houthi Shia rebels in Yemen, while the Houthi Shia rebels are being supported by Iran. You got that? That's what's going on right over there. Plenty far enough away from us, but still right over there. Muhammad, okay, this is areas of the world that are predominantly Sunni, are the green, as you can see, vastly the majority. Predominantly Shia is Iran, some of the areas around Iran, and then pockets, like right here. This is Yemen. That's where we are. I mean, we're right here in the water, but that's Yemen. And they're contained in a limited area, but they're the slight majority there. And then you get Ibadi, which is where we were in Oman. Those are the three biggest parties. There actually are more than that. There are the Alawites, which are in western Syria and in Lebanon. You get the Ahmadi, A-H-M-A, in India and some of those areas, and they have distinctive kind of approaches to this whole thing. I feel like we should all take a nap now. Let's talk about the basic beliefs of Islam. I really try to figure this stuff out. You can go back to your cabin and forget about it. Islam, the word means submission. A Muslim who is an adherent of Islam, and it's the same root word, Islam, Muslim, means one who submits to Allah, the word for God. Muslim life, as I said before, is more about orthopraxy, that is how you act, than it is about orthodoxy, what you believe. That doesn't mean you don't believe particular things. That's why they have different schools of theology. The beliefs of Islam are based upon three things. Primarily the Quran, I'm going to talk about that, which is the holy writing, the recitation, which is what Quran means. Also the Sunnah, which are the life examples that were given by Muhammad. The Quran says, follow the model of Muhammad. And so there's a whole series of commentaries about the works about the life of Muhammad. And then the hadith. The hadith are the sayings of Muhammad and of his companions, those that were close to him. Now the Quran is believed to be the word of God, not the word of Muhammad. Muhammad's words are captured in the hadith, and his how he lived are captured in the sunnah. So, the revelation of Muhammad, also I said before, was in the Arabic language, and that is considered the holy language. They believe that God, Allah, speaks Arabic. And so everyone who is to be a Muslim must be familiar with Arabic. You must state the Shahada in Arabic. Quran, recitation in Arabic, the sacred text, the highest authority, they believe that it is flawless, that what was captured is exactly what the angel Gabriel or Jibreel told them from God, and that there is a perfect copy that has existed eternally in heaven of the Quran. Now, some disagree with that. The Abadis don't believe that the Quran is eternal. They believe that God wrote it and gave it at a certain time. And that's considered a heresy, especially by the very conservative Sunnis and the Shia. The Hadith. And this is very important to understand, because while all Muslims follow the same Quran, they do not follow the same hadith, meaning they have different versions or narratives or reports that record the words and the actions of Muhammad and his companions. And because the hadith is significantly important in creating Sharia law, they don't just look at the Quran when they talk about Islamic law, they look at the hadith as well. Well, there's a few that are shared, but for the most part, the hadith that the Sunnis follow are different from different authors than the hadith that the Shia follow, which means that's why you get different kind of interpretations of the law in different parts of the Islamic world. They're not looking at the same documents. Everyone down here, you can see every one of the hadith has two parts. It is the tradition itself. In other words, what the words of the Prophet actually were, that's called the matin. And then the second part of it is called the isnad. That is the chain of authorities. Who told who told who told who. The isnad is more important. Who said it is more important than what it says. When they read the hadith, they're less concerned about, does this sound like something the Prophet would have said, than do we have a chain of authority that tells us it goes back to the Prophet. And the strongest ones are ones that say the Prophet said. Or, then the next level is, it was heard that a companion heard the Prophet say, or it was heard that that one of the early believers heard from a companion who heard Muhammad say. And the longer the chain is, the less authority it has. But that's more important. Who said it and how they can trace it back is more important than what it says, which is one of the reasons they have different hadith that they follow. And then finally, the sunnah, which means the tradition. Remember the Sunni group? It's based on the same word. The clear, well-trodden path, or the way, or the tradition, that gives the ideal way of life for Muslims based upon the teachings and the lifestyle, the practices of Muhammad. They give his specific words, habits, practices, approvals, and that's what Muslims often will look to in terms of knowing how to relate to your family, your wife, your husband, whatever, how you're supposed to discipline your children, how you're supposed to relate to your boss. That comes more from the Sunnah than anything else. So it's not just one thing, right? These are the articles, the six articles of faith of Islam. And I'm going to go through this pretty quick. I was afraid I was going to run long, and it looks like I'm going to. Again, remember, the beliefs are less important, actually, than the practices. But they do have basic beliefs, six of them. They believe in one God, what's called the Tawhid, the oneness of God. The greatest error, the greatest sin that any Muslim can commit is to compare anything to God, or to consider that there is anything equal to or connected to God. This is called the Tawhid, which means the unity, the oneness of God. And that sin of comparing anything to God or relating anything to God is called shirk, like shirk. That's the unforgivable sin in Islam. Anything else they can deal with, but when you try to compare something to God or relate something to God inappropriately, that is the ultimate sin. They believe in angels of God. Interestingly, angels are in Islam are believed to be spiritual creatures that are entirely good. They don't have a will. They are the messengers and servants of God. And they have some of them, like the angel Gabriel, or Jibreel, that you would recognize, or Mikael, which is the angel Archangel Michael, which are shared in other faiths. But angels cannot do anything wrong. The idea of having a fallen angel, like the devil is a fallen angel in Christian understanding, angels can't fall. They absolutely have to be obedient. But they have another spiritual creature called a jinn. J-I-N-N is the transliterated. That's where we get the idea of a genie. And that's why genies are in the desert, right? Well, they don't believe that they live in lamps or give wishes. But a jinn, unlike an angel, does have a will. He can decide to do good or evil. He may do good things for you, or he may trick you. And so there's always a concern that jinns could be creating a problem. Angels are always good. There's also a belief in the prophets and messengers of God, especially Muhammad. In fact, they differentiate between prophet, someone who speaks for God, and a messenger, someone who brings a written text. Particularly Noah is believed to have been a messenger because he, and then Abraham received what's called the Scrolls of Abraham, which no longer exist. Moses received the Torah, or Torah. Jesus received the Injil, or Gospels. They sort of look over the fact that the Gospels weren't written until after Jesus was gone. Muhammad received the Quran. Muhammad is seen as the seal of the prophets. He is the last one. And he trumps everybody else. They believe Jesus was a prophet. In fact, they have 24 named prophets from the Hebrew and Christian Bible, including Adam, Job, Lot, Ishmael, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, Aaron, Elisha, Zechariah, Jonah, David. David also was received the Psalms, they said, and John the Baptist. But they believe there may be as many as 124,000 prophets. A messenger is sort of the highest level of prophet. But there have been as many as 124,000 prophets, many of whom were not named, who brought God's message to them. Not in a written form. Those are the messengers. But the prophets bring God's word. So they also believe in the books of God, including all of those I just showed you. The Psalms, the Torah, the Gospels, they believe God gave all of those, but all of those have been corrupted. Only the Quran, which is the ultimate one, is not corrupted. They believe in the day of judgment and afterlife, and they believe in the supremacy of God's will and divine decree. What you might call, if you're a Calvinist, predestination. They believe that everything is planned by God, and that's why when someone who's Islamic refers to something, we actually heard our guide say this at one point, he's having trouble with his microphone, and he said, oh, you could hear him sort of muttering, he said, gotta fix this thing, you know, inshallah. Inshallah means if God wills it. Because everything falls under God's plan. There is nothing that's outside God's will or his plan. He's got everything lined up. And so inshallah, if God wills it, then this will be the case. In addition to those six basic beliefs, there are, even more important, the five pillars of Islam. The first one is the profession of faith. It's called the Shahada. It is the statement of what it is to be a Muslim. In fact, to be a Muslim, the only thing you have to do is to recite this correctly in Arabic with belief in your heart. You have to mean it. You have to believe it in the presence of two Islamic witnesses. And you're a Muslim. That's all it takes. The statement in English is basically, there is no God but Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet or messenger. In Arabic, it's La ilaha illa Allah wa Muhammad Rasulallah. That's the Arabic for it. You say that in the presence of witnesses, Islamic witnesses, and mean it, believe it, you are Muslim. There's nothing else required. No classes to take, no baptizing or anything else. So that profession of faith is critical. We then have the prayer, or salah, which occurs five times a day. And you, if you haven't already heard the call to prayer anywhere in your travels, you will hear it in Egypt. Because as you travel along in the bus, from time to time, you'll hear the call to prayer five times a day. The prayer is held at dawn, at midday, afternoon, sunset, and evening. And if you go into a mosque, at least a modern mosque, there will be a digital counter on the wall that tells you, here are the times that will be the call to prayer. And sounds like we're backing up. They're always, in fact, in a lot of countries, this is true in Dubai, in the United Arab Emirates, their goal is to have a mosque every 500 meters, meaning every half a kilometer, so that everyone is able to walk to a mosque and everyone is close enough to hear the call to prayer, which usually comes from the minarets. In ancient times, it was a person would climb up there and do the call to prayer. And the call to prayer includes the Shahada and some other things. And it basically says you know, there is one God, and Muhammad is his prophet. Come to pray, come to pray. And it repeats that. But that's the basic call to prayer. 5 times a day, and they face Mecca. If you go in a mosque on one side, depending on where it is, there will be a thing called a mihrab. It is a niche in the wall. It looks like a doorway without a door in it. That is, the mihrab shows the direction toward Mecca. The direction is important to them. It's called a qibla, that direction. Well, that mihrab will tell which way you're supposed to face, and that's very important. In fact, when you go to St. Catherine's Monastery, there is a mosque that was built inside the walls of the monastery, a Fatimid, when the Fatimid Caliphate was ruling, but they put the mihrab on the wrong wall. It's facing in the wrong direction, so it has never been used for prayer. The Muslims have never had a service in there because it's facing in the wrong direction. You then have generous almsgiving, the zakat, which I mentioned is 2.5% of your wealth each year, your sort of liquid wealth. And you also are expected to give additional offerings, but this can be given to a brother that's in need, or, you know, a friend, or it can be given to the mosque. Now with Shia, they have an additional tax that's supposed to go to support the hidden Mahdi. Remember the guy that's going to come back? He's been gone for 1,000 years, but he's still around. He and his servants, the imams, or the ayatollahs in some cases, you give an extra to help take care of them and to get ready for this guy's return. You then have fasting or saum, which occurs during the entire month of Ramadan. Now, because the lunar calendar is 11 days shorter than the solar calendar, this month of Ramadan shifts earlier each year, and eventually it covers the entire year. And from daybreak until the setting of the sun, you are not allowed to eat or drink. You also are not supposed to curse, not supposed to have sex, all of these things, because it's a time to purify your thoughts, to purify your life, to think. And also when you get hungry, it's to be aware of the fact that there are hungry people and be more sympathetic and compassionate. Fascinating. How many of you went up the Burj Khalifa, the tallest building in the world in Dubai? Okay. Because of the fact that it's from sunrise to sunset, the people who live and work in the Burj Khalifa, they had to come up with a completely different set of rules because the sunrise is visible up there a long time before anybody on the ground sees it. And it stays up longer. So they had a different set of rules as to when you had to start fasting and stop fasting. You then have the pilgrimage to Mecca, or the Hajj as it's called, once in a person's life, assuming they can afford it. If you can't, for instance, the fasting, if you're sick or pregnant, if you're traveling, you're not required to do that. There are exceptions. If you, in terms of zakat, if you are in need financially, you are not required to pay that. If you are financially capable, you are expected once in your life to go to Mecca, to commit the pilgrimage in Mecca, and in doing so, to go through a series of ritualistic kind of activities. So these five, and I'll talk about the Hajj in a second. The Hajj includes several things. You walk 7 times around the Kaaba. This is the Kaaba. This is what it looks like during Hajj, when they have approaching 3 million people here. This mosque is the holiest of all places to Muslims, and it's called the Al-Masjid Al-Haram Mosque. This Kaaba is the temple that it's thought was built by Adam. It was cleared out by Abraham and Ishmael from its idols, and they later were put back, and then this is where Muhammad, after he was victorious over the Meccans, he cleared it out as well. It is the holiest of all places. It's toward this that everybody faces in the world when they face toward Mecca. Well, all of these people, they perform the Tawrat, which is to walk 7 times, actually this way, counterclockwise, 7 times around the Kaaba. They then will, over in this area, in fact I've got a little chart here, this shows you more what it's like up close. This is a diagram. You walk 7 times the tawaf around. You then go in, and this is all undercover now, between Al-Marwa and Al-Safa, that are 2 hills. This is in recognition of the fact that when Hagar and Ishmael, her son, were sent out, they go here and they think they're going to die. And so Hagar's running back and forth between these 2 hills to try to find water. She then comes back to where she had set her son down, and that is there was a spring there. That is the well of Zamzam. So after you walk seven times around, you go back and forth between the hills of Al-Safa and Al-Marwa. You drink from the fountain of Zamzam. You then go out to Mount the plains of Mount Arafat, and you spend a time in vigil. You spend a night on the plain of Muzdalifa. You have a ritual stoning of the devil. There are three stone pillars out there, and you throw stones at these pillars as a symbol of stoning the devil and driving him away. And then there's a time the followers shave their heads, they have an animal sacrifice, and a three-day festival following that. Now, I mentioned these five pillars. Amongst Shia, at least amongst the sevener Shia, they have two more. Walaya is the guardianship of the faith. And because the very severe, the very serious Shia, guardianship of the faith is one of their pillars, that's why we have had some fairly aggressive Shiite leaders, because that's one of their pillars. And the seventh one is Tahaya, which is cleanliness of soul, of clothing, of body. So these images, I want to, are you okay for five more minutes?
Yeah.
Are we all right? If you need to leave, that's okay. Sorry to go so long. The rise of political Islam. Political Islam, or Islamism as it's called, is the belief that Islam as a religion should guide not only our religious life, but it should guide our social and political, and as well as personal life. And that has taken various movements. Within Sunni, the majority of Islam, it has developed into what's called the Salafi movement. Muhammad said when he was alive that the people of my own generation are the best, and followed by the next generation, and then the next generation after that. Salafi means ancestors, and it is a desire to go back and act like, live like, follow the precepts of people that lived in the 7th century. And so it is very conservative. It is kind of anti-modern. It tends to follow the early Muslim examples. I've used the word before, Wahhabis, the Wahhabist movement in Saudi Arabia, for instance. To a lot of Muslims in the Salafi movement, sometimes that's seen as synonymous, the Salafis or Wahhabis, because there was an imam, a leader, called the Wahhab, and he was very conservative. Now that is the predominant, that is the majority of people in Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia is the most conservative Muslim country in the world. Most Americans don't get that because Saudi Arabia is our ally. But the Wahhabist movement, the Salafi movement in Saudi Arabia is the most conservative. Women are not allowed to drive. They have no political rights. It is very strict. And in fact, there's a real concern. The family Saud, the wealthy royal family in Saudi Arabia, really like their relationship with the West, because where do they sell their oil? That's where their money comes from. Their wealth, their influence, their power. And so the royal family keeps a lid on all this, but there is a very strong undercurrent of people who want to sort of rise up and get rid of all this modern influence and go back to the ancestral time. In fact, the Wahhabist or Salafi movement in Saudi Arabia is the same theological underpinning as ISIL. ISIL or ISIS. ISIL is a better, Daesh in Hebrew. ISIL is a better translation because it's not just Syria. It's not the Islamic State of Iraq and Syria. It's better translation is the Islamic State of Iraq and Levant, that whole area. And there's been a real fear that there might be a rising up of people. And we don't think this is an immediate concern, but the question's raised. Since they have the same theological orientation, is there a danger that some of the very conservative Saudi Wahhabists might rise up and say, we agree with those guys? Right now, the Saudi royal family is keeping a lid on all of that, and they're pretty strict about it. But that has been a concern. So the Salafi movement in Sunni Islam is the very conservative Islamist, and that's what when you say Islamism, that ism means that's the belief that it should control all political life as well as social personal life. And Wahhabism, as I say, is an extreme reform movement from coming from Muhammad ibn Abd al-Wahhab from the 1700s. Wahhab, as the imam, joined together with the founder of the family Saud and helped him come to power. And there's a relationship between the royal family and the Wahhabists because of that. But they keep a lid on it. ISIL or ISIS, or they name themselves the Islamic State. Last June of 2014, the head of ISIL, which I think is, they call themselves just the Islamic State now, but most of the rest of the world won't give them that. They won't say, you are not the Islamic State. The leader, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, declared in June of 2014 that he was the new caliph, which meant he was the heir to Muhammad and the ruler, therefore, the one in charge, over all of Islam. To date, over 120 different Muslim religious leaders, including the Grand Mufti of Egypt and Saudi Arabia, some of the most important leaders in Islam, have said, not hardly, Charlie, you know, you do not represent us, we are not going to follow you, you are not the caliph. And for a while, everybody was frightened because it looked like they couldn't lose. Well, they're being defeated pretty royally in a number of different fronts right now. So, but that's where they're coming from. They want, and that's why when he declared himself the caliph, he said, we are now the Islamic State, not the Islamic State of Iraq and Levant. We are the Islamic State. Nobody else will give him that. But this is the sort of movement that exists in political Islam. As of the 13th of April this year, the gray area here, this is Syria, Iraq, okay? The gray area is what's controlled by ISIL. You can see the chart here. Others controlled by Syrian rebels, by the Syrian government, by the Iraq government, down here, the pink, and by Syrian Kurds, by Iraqi Kurds. There's a whole lot of different folks playing in that sandbox right now and fighting each other over it. But that actually, if you had a chart from a year before this, six months before this, they had a larger area of territory, and they are being pushed back now by the Iraqi army, by the Kurdish fighters, by the Syrian military and government, etc. And I personally think it's only a matter of time, okay, because people are not buying it. I am sorry for having gone so long. Any questions about any of that stuff? Why do I get laughter when I ask that? Oh, the satanic verses. That actually was created by Salman Rushdie. I mean, looking at the relationship. That, by the way, there's one question somebody asked me before about why is the moon and the crescent moon and the star a symbol of Islam? Some people, and I've actually read this on the internet, say, oh, well, Islam is they worship the moon goddess, the goddess Sin, and so therefore it's actually a pagan religion. That's not only not true, it's silly. The crescent moon and star are symbols of, that exists on more flags and more banners and more symbols than anything in the world. I mean, there are provinces in Sweden that have that on their flag. What happened, it's believed, is that when the Turks, who had been a pagan people, and they had included worship of the moon goddess, when they came into the Middle East, and they fought for the Abbasid Empire and then took over as the Seljuk Turks, that had been their symbol, that had been their flag. Well, when they took over, and eventually took over Turkey, the Turkish flag has those symbols. And it's believed that it had no particular symbolic meaning except that had been the flag they'd always had. And so they carried it over. It does not indicate worship of the moon or anything else, because Turkey was the central point of the Ottoman Empire. Then that became the Ottoman flag, and it became recognized as a symbol for Islam under the Ottoman Empire. And so it exists now in a lot of different flags and that sort of thing. It does not have any particular symbolism. In fact, you'll struggle to try to find any explanation for what it represents. Some people have said it's because they have a lunar calendar, and it's the new moon is when they start their months, and that reflects, you know, the beginning of the new moon is the crescent. There's several other reasons, but there is no symbolism about that that has any real, you know, bearing. It just carried over to the Ottoman Empire and has continued since then. Thank you all very much for your patience and for being